Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Dogs of War by Michael Anderle, narrated by James R. Cheatham. Chapter 1.
Excuse me, but I have to ask, are you the hero I saw on the news?
She was on her way to the bar and turned on her heel to see who the cultured voice, was that a Boston Brahmin accent, belonged to. It was a handsome older gentleman with a salt-and-pepper beard and friendly eyes. He extended his strong, smooth hand for her to shake. He was not the type of man who approached her every day. She shook his hand and took note of his bespoke suit and tasteful but expensive watch.
My name is Alicia. Alicia Joni.
This was true, but everyone who knew her called her Agony. Not many people wanted to introduce themselves as Agony, though. The man flashed an honest and endearing smile. Warmth sparkled in his deep brown eyes.
Well, Miss Joni, would you allow me to buy you a drink in honor of your heroism?
Agony opened her mouth to say no, but changed her mind. She was here with Payne, but he'd spent the last few minutes talking on the phone with his ex-girlfriend Amy. Months had passed since their release from Peregrine Rock, but Payne had done nothing to move things forward between them. Now he'd left her alone. Why the hell shouldn't she enjoy a drink with a new acquaintance? He was hardly the first to buy her a drink tonight. The bartender had even given them a round on the house, including drinks for Zeke, Marty, Yolanda, Payne, and Agony. They were heroes. There was no harm in celebrating.
Sure,
she smiled.
What are you drinking?
He seemed pleased. It was nice to feel like somebody wanted to spend time with her, especially a man who looked like he might have a private jet. Agony was not a gold digger, but the finer things in life were nothing to sneer at.
I'll have a cosmopolitan.
He returned in a few minutes with that and an old-fashioned for himself. He handed it over, and she smiled. Of course he drank old-fashions. What else would a classy older gentleman drink? With that same warmth in his eyes, he held up his glass and gave a toast designed to sweep her off her feet.
To a beautiful heroine worthy of the likes of Atlanta and Cyrene.
Agony was rusty on her Greek mythology, but she remembered they were female heroes. A flattering comparison to her reeling self-esteem. As Agony sipped her cosmopolitan, her head swam. This was not how her evening had begun. What the hell had happened? It had started when she'd come into the office with Payne that evening. They'd wrapped up their biggest case in a while. A shot in the arm for their private detective business. They had been bantering about it.
A plot twist, Payne frowned as they entered the building. Simple missing person job. 19-year-old college student. Exactly the low-key job we said we'd focus on when we got out of prison. No reason to anticipate a magic mushroom cult.
Agony chuckled.
To be fair, is there ever a reason to expect a magic mushroom cult? Yeah, they didn't anticipate the way this played out. Girl goes on a hiking trip with friends, they lose track of her, and she goes missing for months. Okay, well, the cops are on it. For what that's worth. Then,
Payne picked up the thread as they approached the elevator.
Then she gets spotted buying junk food at a gas station at the city's edge before disappearing again. Naturally, the cops treat that as proof she doesn't want to be found. She's alive and must know about the search for her. It's been all over the news.
They stepped into the elevator. Agony pressed the button.
She's 19. She's legally an adult. The cops have no reason to pursue it further. The parents swear up and down that something isn't right. When the cops don't listen, they come to the renowned Pain and Agony Detective Agency, famous for proving accusations of marital infidelity and finding grandmas who have wandered off. We pick up the trail, expecting a nice, easy case like all the others we've had lately, and instead...
Payne laughed. We stumble on a cult using hallucinogenic drugs to control its members. Naturally, it's more like our old cases than our new low-stress ones, but what the hell? We have to have a little fun now and then to stay in practice, right?
The elevator door slid open, and they walked into the corridor leading to their new office. Payne stopped as if he didn't want their employees to hear his next words.
Seriously, that was a lot of fun. It almost makes me regret our decision to try to stay out of trouble.
If you ever regret that, think back to Peregrine Rock. Payne, that was the most awful experience in my life.
Payne frowned.
Yeah, it wasn't great. Too many improvised weapons and homemade knives for a top-rated Airbnb. 0 stars. Would not recommend.
I'm glad you can joke about it. When I think about the number of women who tried to stab or bludgeon me to death with a blunt object in there, it doesn't bear thinking about.
Payne shrugged.
I've always found the best therapy for PTSD is to inflict violence on someone else. Take this case, for example. You can't tell me it wasn't fun bashing heads once we'd cracked the case and found the cult's hideout.
Agony started walking down the corridor again, and Payne followed. There was no harm in talking in front of Yolanda and company. So what if they were both nostalgic for the bad old days?
If they hadn't tried to cover their tracks, they wouldn't have gotten their heads cracked. Yeah, that was fun.
She approached the door of their office suite and glanced at the plaque. M. Payne and A. Joni, private investigators. She looked at Payne mischievously.
What's your first name these days?
Payne grinned.
He was often Max, but in prison he'd been Maddox. Max Payne and Mad Payne. They were dumb jokes, but he enjoyed them.
I don't know. How about Minor?
She punched him in the arm.
I think not. That's not even a name.
Well, Major is a name. I saw it in a list of baby names.
Agony blushed. Why was Payne looking at baby names? It was awkward, considering their situation was unresolved. Not that they'd considered having a baby, but still. Neither Payne nor Agony had made any move toward a real relationship, which put them in an odd spot. While in prison, Agony dealt with her mortality and the primal fear of dying alone. As for Payne, he'd lived a hard and dangerous life for many years and didn't want an unprepared person like his girlfriend Amy to suffer. That was why they'd broken up. He told Agony that Amy wasn't like him while Agony was. They'd left it there without another word for a strange reason. The threats that drove them together were no longer in the picture, now that they focused on easier and safer bread-and-butter detective jobs. They didn't seize the moment by seizing each other, and now they'd started drifting apart. They still bantered and gave each other as much grief as ever, but that was a shield, a smokescreen so they wouldn't have to acknowledge that they had been honest about their growing feelings for each other not long ago or what had seemed so. I love you. I need you. Those words had been on her lips as they dodged bullets and ducked knives when death was close to them every day. The monotony of the current daily grind had made them much harder to say. Now that their typical workday was about internet research and taking photos from rooftops, she was stuck on the long-term consequences of telling Payne what she wanted. She didn't want to mess up the good thing they had, and she assumed Payne felt the same. He stared at her quizzically.
You planning on opening the door anytime soon? Or moving aside so I can do it?
Agony sighed to cover her embarrassment. He'd caught her daydreaming about their non-existent relationship.
You know what, Payne? Major would be a great first name for you. Major Payne suits you perfectly.
She opened the door and went into the office. Marty grinned at them.
I wondered how long the two of you was going to stand in front of the door like that.
Yolanda raised an eyebrow. She sat on the edge of Marty's desk like she belonged there.
Seriously, you two? You trying to be secretive or something?
Zeke, the janitor, was nearby, mopping leisurely. Now that he had a single office to worry about rather than 14 suites, Zeke's workday was not too demanding. He looked up as they came in and put his mop in the bucket next to him.
Congrats, you two.
Agony frowned, confused.
Congrats? What for?
Marty snorted.
What for? Being on the news, of course. Like genuine celebrities.
Yeah.
Yolanda was indignant that Agony didn't understand what Marty was talking about.
The police said you'd made a major contribution to the case. That's a big deal, you know.
Payne shut the office door behind them.
You're right. It is. In fact, we met with the lawyer for the missing girl's obscenely wealthy parents and received a large payout that will keep the Payne and Joni agency healthy for some time. This was a good one.
Right!
Marty slapped his hands together.
So, what are we doing to celebrate?
Everybody was flying higher than usual. They felt good after a successful case with a big payout and no complications. Payne looked at Agony and grinned.
Yeah, what are we doing to celebrate?
Her anxious feelings gone, Agony smiled back.
We're going out for dinner and drinks. That's what we're doing. Everything's on us.
Yolanda smiled.
Now you're talking. Let me get my vape pen.
Payne threw Agony a look, but Yolanda didn't notice. She was too busy rooting in her desk for the vape pen. She wasn't a bad secretary. They'd been lucky to keep her when they moved offices. Still, she had the irritating habit of noisy, unrelenting gum chewing. When she'd finally quit the gum, Agony had been overjoyed. That was before the vaping started.
So glad I quit that gum chewing.
Yolanda opened and closed drawers in her desk and threw things around. A common occurrence since she lost her vape pen at least once daily.
Chewing that stuff was giving me man jaw. Gotta keep myself feminine.
Marty grinned, crossed his hands behind his head, and leaned back in his chair so far that Agony was concerned he'd flip over.
She's fucking American and I love it.
When he got out of Peregrine Rock prison a few weeks after they did, Payne and Agony had offered the huge Cockney a job handling security for their new location. Marty had demonstrated his competence to their satisfaction in his brief time on the job. He'd also established a flirtation with their secretary. This was as much of a surprise to Marty as it was to anyone else, and Agony didn't think she'd ever get used to it. She couldn't think of the former gum-chewing, now constantly vaping Yolanda as an object of romantic interest. Still, to each his own.
You looking for your vape?
Asked Zeke, fishing in his jeans pocket. Most of the time, when Yolanda lost her vape pen, she had put it down somewhere. Zeke came across it during his cleaning duties, then squirreled it away until she started looking for it. She stood and looked at the janitor with exasperation.
Yeah, you got it?
Zeke handed it over. Yolanda held it and looked around.
Now, where did I put my bag?
They were as lucky to have held on to Zeke. He was moving a little slower these days, but he still had the thousand moves he'd always claimed. He was in a much better mood now that he was getting paid to clean one suite of offices instead of 14. On the other hand, they'd been forced to offer him a substantial pay raise and a promise that things would not go down the way they had the last time.
Just give me a few minutes, and then we'll go. Payne, run a comb through your hair.
Agony went into her office to get ready. Her fashion choices were simple. She favored big sunglasses and long trench coats. But this was a celebration, so she wanted to dress up. As she did her makeup, Agony thought about how much things had changed since they'd moved into their new offices. It wasn't just their location, but their whole world. Their offices were smaller, for one thing. They weren't part of a big complex, but in a small suite of rooms downtown, not far from the nightclub where Payne and Agony had first met. They'd ended up in trouble with a crew of Neapolitan mobsters, fought back to back, and learned they were good at doing so. That was the type of job they used to do, involving broken bones and flying bullets. Since getting out of prison, they'd taken on jobs like finding runaway college students and checking on whether husbands were cheating. That was what private detectives did to earn a living. Neapolitan organized crime families were not normal in most PIs' lives, nor were rogue ex-spies or terrorist mercenaries or any of the other things they had run into before they'd started behaving themselves. Things were calmer now. Every so often, they'd get an exciting job. Guns would be drawn or somebody would need knocking about. As a result of their efforts, not to mention the Operation Revelation worm they'd released a while ago, their world was a bit better. The cops were doing their jobs, or more than they used to. Politicians seemed less corrupt. When it came down to it, the rampant criminality and abuse of power that drove the engine of the Pain and Agony partnership were fading. They had put themselves out of business, at least regarding the high-risk jobs. While applying bright red lipstick in front of a little mirror, Agony wondered whether this was the cause of the distance between her and Payne. Were the two of them such agents of chaos that they couldn't function as a pair without it? That wasn't a happy thought. After snapping her mirror shut and clicking the cap of her lipstick on, Agony resolved to shake off that line of thinking. She walked into the office suite and smiled.
Let's go have fun.
An hour later, they sat at a popular downtown pub and ordered a meal. Payne and Zeke ordered burgers. Due to his size, Payne made his a double. Marty ordered the fish and chips and complained bitterly that a proper fish dinner was a single large piece, not two smaller ones. Yolanda got a salad, although she kept excusing herself to vape out front. They were all enjoying themselves, Agony as much as anyone else. They had a round of beers with their food, and Marty was unimpressed with the selection, mostly American IPAs or canned pish, as he called it. The free drinks started when the evening news report came up on the TV. They drank, exchanged war stories, and were having a good time when Agony noticed her face on the TV along with Payne's. Police are crediting local detectives Max Payne and Alicia Joni with being instrumental in rescuing missing college student Jenny Caltrip, who was discovered in the custody of the Church of the True Vision, a suspected cult. The bartender looked at them, then the screen, then back at them. Finally, he called,
"Hey, there they are! A round of drinks for our heroes, eh, guys?"
The crowd roared, and Agony's heart swelled. She was accustomed to being blamed for their work rather than praised for it, especially after having been locked up in prison for a few months after busting up a crack house. Buoyed by their newfound popularity, recent success, companionship, and two or three cocktails, Agony decided tonight was the night. It was time for her to tell Payne how she felt about him. Even after her melancholy thoughts at the office, she was certain he would respond in kind. It was how he smiled at her from across the table and the effects of alcohol on her judgment. She didn't want an audience for this conversation, though. As she looked around, Yolanda returned from her latest vaping session and sat next to her to flirt with Marty.
Hey, Yolanda.
Agony didn't speak up, and Yolanda was focused on the big Brit. So she had to try again.
Hey, Yolanda.
The woman swiveled around.
Yes, hun? Have you ever seen Marty throw darts? You should check this out. His skills are something.
Marty grinned, convinced of the truth of this statement, even though Agony knew it was bullshit. The truth was, he had no real dart-throwing skills unless you counted his ability to throw the dart so hard that they damaged the brick under the board. He thought that was the game's point.
Let me show you, love. I can throw darts harder than any man alive.
Yolanda smiled, impressed with his strength.
Okay, count me in.
The two meandered toward the dartboard. Yolanda was tipsy enough to lean on Marty for support as they crossed the room. Zeke picked up on what she was doing, or maybe he wanted to see Marty's skills as well. He followed them, leaving Agony alone to talk to Payne. There was only one problem. He went to follow them. Agony grabbed his arm.
Hold back a minute, Payne. I want to talk to you.
He looked at her, distracted by the festive mood.
Huh? I wanted to get in on that dart game.
Payne, you are a major pain. Just listen for a minute.
The Pink Panther theme started playing, and Payne reached into his pocket. Agony couldn't believe her bad luck. He was getting a call when she'd gotten up the courage to talk to him about her feelings.
Who is it?
He frowned at his phone screen.
It's Amy. I gotta take this.
Agony's stomach sank, but she wasn't ready to give up.
Payne, call her back. I've got something I need to talk to you about.
He didn't reply. She wasn't sure he'd even heard her. He took the call and walked off to talk to Amy in private.
Shit.
Agony slumped in her chair. This was not how she had thought things would go. She'd been so convinced that tonight was the night. That Payne was ready to hear what she had to say. Ready to open his heart the way she was planning to. Instead, he'd blown her off to take a call from his ex-girlfriend. As far as Agony was concerned, Payne's ridiculous behavior proved he still had a thing for Amy, despite everything he'd said outside Peregrine Rock. Agony didn't register what he said on the phone. She heard phrases like, "We planned this weeks ago," and "You know how much she means to me," but didn't put two and two together. Amy had called to cancel Payne's plan to take her daughter Addie to the shooting range, which he'd been planning to do since he'd rescued her from her kidnappers. It was not a romantic call, but Agony was so caught up in her anxiety that she didn't notice. Instead, she got up to join the dart game. As she crossed the room, Marty threw a dart so hard it went through the board and the sharp tip stuck out the other side. It wasn't a scoring shot, but it was powerful.
Let me show you how it's done.
She walked to the board and tried to pull out Marty's dart, but the thing refused to wiggle loose, and she wasn't strong enough to pull it free. She turned to Marty.
Would you mind?
No worries. It's like the sword and the stone, ain't it?
He put his hand against the dartboard and pulled the dart out with ease. The head came off and dropped to the floor.
Oh, well. Don't worry, she'll screw back together.
You think the dart is a girl?
Marty paused before picking it up and looked at her, bemused. Then he grinned and straightened.
A dart has every quality of a girl. It's curvy, smooth, sharp, and easy to throw.
Yolanda burst out laughing, and Agony joined in, or she tried to. She was still down, but everyone else was having a good time except Payne, who was talking to his ex-girlfriend. During the next 20 minutes, Agony made it clear that she had dart skills. although Marty was still proud of his ability to puncture the board. Her mood improved, she started having fun, and she only needed a little extra alcohol.
"Be back in a minute, guys. Gotta refill my drink."
She turned to go, allowing Marty to continue demonstrating his impressive, if inaccurate, dart throwing to Yolanda, even though she lacked the muscular bulk to make the technique work for her. The tall and lanky New England gentleman appeared out of nowhere, giving her a gentle yet inviting smile. Her Cosmo didn't taste right.
"Stupid bartender."
She smacked her lips, trying to figure out what that odd aftertaste was. The gentleman smiled at her, relishing his old-fashioned. She sipped again, determined to drink enough to enjoy this evening. If Payne wanted to mess around, he could watch her having a great time with another man.
"Stupid Payne."
"As you drink."
She shrugged.
"I'm not sure this guy knows what cranberry juice is. Listen, you should come and join our gathering. We'll need another player for darts when my partner gets back. My, business partner."
She was vaguely aware that she wanted to make Payne jealous, but her new acquaintance had no idea.
"That's an excellent suggestion. Lead the way."
She attempted to do so, but as she moved toward the dartboard, Agony's world got wobbly. The floor felt like it was dissolving beneath her, and her legs lost solidity. It was too late to do anything about it, but she understood the weird aftertaste in her cosmopolitan was not the bartender's fault. She wondered why she wasn't worried. She should be scared, should be angry, should be blaming someone. But she couldn't feel that. All she felt was a strong, smooth hand holding hers. Her world became a warm smile and a well-trimmed salt and pepper beard. It got larger until it generated a gravitational field, and she fell into it. Everything bled together, then went black. Chapter 2. When Agony opened her eyes, it was daytime. The sun was shining, although based on the quality of the light, it was late afternoon. So far, so good. It was normal to wake up late the next day when you've had too much to drink. Maybe not this late, or not often, but late was normal. If only that was all. She'd been walking across the pub to the dartboard and something had happened. She'd felt dizzy and closed her eyes to get a grip. She hadn't laid down. She hadn't even sat down. Now, she was in a situation that didn't seem right or possible. She was in the woods. That was the disturbing part. No Payne, no Marty, no Yolanda, no Zeke. Just Alicia Joni, alone in a thick primeval forest. She looked around, searching for a clue to explain her surroundings. She was barefoot, although she didn't remember taking off her shoes. Her feet hurt. She was also out of breath. That implied she'd been running, possibly for a long time. Had someone been chasing her? Her chest was heaving, so maybe she'd been running for her life. Only trouble was, she couldn't remember having done so. She was wet. Had she been in the water? She looked at her clothes, but it wasn't water on her shirt. That was blood. Agony checked herself for wounds. Her sense of time was still off. Hell, her sense of reality was still off.
"There's probably still something in my system."
Whoever that guy was, with his kind eyes and upper-class New England accent, the bastard must have roofied her. That made sense, but nothing else did.
"I should never have trusted him. I should never have taken a drink from his hand."
She was embarrassed and ashamed, but she shut those feelings down in favor of practicality. If a drug was still in her system, she needed to stay calm and figure out how to call for help. First things first, there were tall, dark trees everywhere that looked like they'd been there for centuries. She'd sit against a tree trunk and breathe slowly and deeply until she calmed enough to figure out her next steps. She picked a likely tree, then slid down and sat with her back against it. It was disorienting to jump from nighttime in a crowded pub to late afternoon in a thick forest. She couldn't wrap her head around it, although, logically, she realized Boston Brahmin man must have transported her out here for a reason. Was that his blood on her shirt? She smiled grimly. If he'd drugged her and transported her to his private forest, intending to rape her or kill her or eat her or a sick combination of all three, it would be a beautiful plot twist if she'd beaten him to death instead. Was he lying elsewhere in the woods, his body likely to remain undiscovered for decades until a random hunter or backpacker stumbled across him? That thought made her happy until she realized he could still be alive. He could be looking for her, scouring the forest for his escaped prey. She shuddered. She had to get out of this forest, although she had no idea how. She didn't know where she was, so even if she reached someone, she couldn't tell them where to find her. Her phone. If it still had charge, she could look up her location and use that to get help. She fished in her pockets, but it took her a minute to find the phone. It was the drugs. Whatever he'd put in her drink must have been powerful. Or she would have thought about her phone before now. She would have found it much more easily after having thought of it. Where was the damn thing? She heard the theme song to Secret Agent Man and realized Payne was calling her. She found it quickly now that it was ringing and fumbled it out of her pocket. As she hit the green button, Agony swallowed to wet her throat.
Yes?
She sounded like an angry crow. She swallowed again, then repeated her question.
Yes, it's Agony.
Agony, where the hell are you? Are you all right?
She struggled to her feet.
Narnia. I'm in Narnia.
What are you talking about? You sound disoriented. Look, Agony, we're all freaked out. You went missing last night. No one has been able to find you for the better part of a day.
I met a handsome man. He took me out to the country. I'm among trees.
Agony's intention had been to tell Payne about meeting the handsome man at the bar, how she had presumably been roofied, and that she was in the middle of a deep forest. It wasn't coming out right. She suspected that she sounded incoherent. The distortion of her perceptions and thoughts made it hard to focus. She was scared and confused and angry.
Wherever I am, it's not home. I am sticky, sticky with blood.
Whose blood?
Payne's voice was so worried that he sounded angry. Agony tried to answer him.
A nice man's?
That wasn't what she meant to say. She meant that the blood might belong to the gentleman with the salt and pepper beard, who she suspected of roofying her. She couldn't get any sensible words to come out.
Listen, Agony.
Payne's voice was serious. The tone he used when he wanted people to pay close attention and thus increase their chances of surviving the next few minutes.
I need you to tell me where you are. I will come and get you.
She looked around, but it just looked like a thick, dark forest. She had the vague suspicion that she'd had another plan for figuring out where she was, but Payne's call had wiped it out of her mind.
Where am I? Well, where am I? I mean, really, Payne, where the hell am I?
A surge of drug-fueled paranoia and fear raced through her as her body ramped up with adrenaline. until she figured out where she was, she would be caught in a full-blown panic attack. Her heart pounded, and blood rushed through her head. She heard Payne's voice, but the words were meaningless.
Agony, I need you to calm down. Calm down!
Agony paced, gazing through the trees, hoping to see a road sign telling her how many miles away Payne was. With the adrenaline racing through her body, she was ready for anything from a pack of wild dogs to an attack by a grizzly bear. Someone made the mistake of grabbing her arm. Under normal conditions, taking Agony's arm from behind would not have been a good idea. She was as fast as a snake, a trained fighter, and had been accustomed to violence for several years. Right now, grabbing Agony's arm from behind was worse than a bad idea. It ensured self-harm, like putting your hand in a whirling propeller. Agony spun and caught the person's wrist, then jammed their elbow with the other hand to hyperextend it. A man shrieked in agony as she made one of his joints flex in the wrong direction. His second shriek was much worse, like the screams of the devils in hell rather than anything human. A second attacker slammed into her from in front, knocking her sprawling. She rolled up and out of it as the man who had tackled her closed in. He kept coming, more concerned with barreling into her than judging the distance properly or adjusting his tactics to do what she was doing. She lashed out with her foot and kicked him so hard in the midsection that he doubled over, retching. Then she kneed him in the face and he fell over backward. Agony paused and looked at the men writhing in pain in front of her. The one she'd kicked, the less injured of the two, looked at her with huge eyes, his expression an ugly combination of fury and terror. She didn't like how he looked at her, so she pulled back her foot to give him a knockout kick that would teach him better manners. She noticed he wore a ranger's uniform. It had a patch on the side that said, Park Ranger. This man was a park ranger, and she had given him two brutal kicks. She looked at his buddy whose arm she'd messed up. This guy also wore a ranger uniform.
Shit.
The fog of the drugs was slowly lifting. Agony became increasingly aware that she had committed two major felonies. She hadn't meant to, but that wasn't how these guys would see it.
Sorry, you two. You surprised me.
The string of obscenities with which they replied to her was not encouraging. On the other hand, neither had yet pulled his gun. She had lost her phone, but she could still hear Payne's voice shouting on the other end.
Agony, what's going on? Is someone attacking you? Agony, where are you, goddammit?
She wanted to tell him, but she didn't know where her phone was, so she couldn't tell him anything. The two park rangers were still cursing her in inventive ways. She listened for Payne's voice and determined the phone was in the underbrush a few feet away. She had to get down on her hands and knees to look for it. She ran the risk that one of the park rangers would recover enough to get on his feet and arrest her.
Hey, you two, don't get up. Stay right there and rest.
This was meant to keep them from coming after her, but the words came out slurred and barely comprehensible. Agony got on all fours and looked for her phone. She heard Payne's voice, but couldn't tell where it was coming from. As she tried to focus on it, she heard police sirens blaring nearby. To someone who had believed she was lost in the deep woods, this sound was as unexpected as hearing the roar of a polar bear while sitting in a baseball stadium. Her jaw dropped.
What the hell? I thought it was in the middle of the forest.
A winding strip of dirt snaked through the woods not far away from her. A forest service road. She hadn't been able to see it before because it was a narrow path, but she could make it out now. She wasn't as deep in the woods as she had thought. That wasn't a good thing considering she had assaulted a pair of park rangers.
What should she do? No one had seen her ID yet. They had no idea who she was. If she ran into the woods, they would have no way of finding her, or finding her body. These woods could be very extensive for all she knew. If she ran, she'd likely wander for days, if not weeks, before she died, leaving her body for the forest creatures. Like it or not, she had no choice but to turn herself in and try to explain that it was all an unfortunate misunderstanding. She sighed and stood as the sheriff's truck pulled up. Two deputies hopped out, a man and a woman. Agony opened her mouth, intending to explain her presence and assert her status as a law-abiding citizen who rarely, if ever, assaulted park rangers. Intentionally. The deputies yelled, "Hey, you down there! Put your hands on your head where I can see them!" The park rangers both shouted, "Officer down! Officer down!" The two sheriff's deputies ran over while Agony explained her situation. What she meant to say was,
"Officers, there was an unfortunate misunderstanding. I'm suffering from mild amnesia after being drugged and dumped in this forest. When the park ranger grabbed my arm, I mistook him for an attacker and injured him. No offense intended. I also hurt the other park ranger. As you can see, I'm trying to find my phone so I can tell my partner Payne what's going on. Perhaps you could assist?"
What came out of her mouth was,
"Phone. I gotta get my phone." Her
words were... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.